Amen. Good morning. Give a praise offering to God. Aren't you glad to be in the house of the Lord this morning? You may have a seat. Welcome to the temple. My name's Kurt, and I'm on the team here. I'm part of the staff here at the temple. We're so glad that you decided to come and worship with us this morning. I hope everyone had a good Thanksgiving. Hope you were able to eat plenty and rest a little bit, and you made it here. So you got the memo that we have new service times starting today. We have an 8:45 a.m. Contemporary service, and then at 9:15, Dana teaches a class on the book of Romans, and I'm teaching a class called Introduction to the Bible at 9:15 on Sunday mornings, and then it's done in time to come here for the 10 o'clock contemporary, and then we have an 11:15 traditional service right after this one. So that's our new schedule. We love it, and we had a great turnout at the first service, so we praise the Lord for that. We're a little nervous, like, is anyone going to come at 8:45, but we had a great turnout. We were thankful for that. Hey, if this is one of the first times you've ever been to the temple, or you want to know more about who we are, or if you have questions about anything you see or hear today, you should have been handed a worship guide when you came in the door. At the bottom of that, there's a connect card. Just fill out that connect card and drop it in the offering buckets as you leave the auditorium, and I will get a hold of you tomorrow and help answer any questions you have or get you connected into a small group or in a serving or a Bible study. I will help you get plugged in here at the temple, and I love doing that for people, and I enjoy doing it, so just let me know what you need. Well, let's go to the Lord in prayer. We'll continue in worship. God, this morning we thank you for being a God who's just always present. We thank you for being the God who created the universe. You hung the stars where they stand today, but you also know our name, and you love us, and you care about us. And God, today, I'm thankful for a God who's a very personal God to each and every one of us individually. And I thank you that you know our stresses, you know our anxiety, you know our worry, you know our joys, you know our dreams and our hopes. So God, we thank you for knowing us and creating us all unique and in your image, in your likeness. And God, I pray this morning that through this worship and through our pastor preaching and teaching your word, that we can know you better and give us even a stronger desire to know you as a personal God in an intimate relationship. God, I thank you so much for the cross and what Jesus did on that cross that allowed us to be redeemed. God, we love you this morning. It's in your son's name we pray. Amen.
Let's stand this morning. We're going to sing about God's reckless love. Good morning. kick down, thy you won't tear down, coming after me. Come on, y'all believe that? Sing it out. There's no shadow you won't light up, mountains you won't climb up, coming after me. There's no wall you won't kick down, thy you won't tear down, coming after me. There's no shadow you won't light up.
Father, we give you glory, we give you praise today, God. We just thank you for who you are and what you do, for you are a God who loves us. You are a God who is not content with being away from us. For you chase us down, you fight till you find us. And God, when you find us, you don't find us to beat us, you don't find us to judge us, you find us to forgive us. You find us to heal us. You find us to make us whole. Thank you, God, for your love and your goodness to us today. In Jesus' name, and all God's people said, amen. You may be seated in the presence of the Lord. Today is the beginning of Advent, which means that word is a word we throw around in the, you know, it's kind of a churchy world, but it means expectation or coming. And when it was created, it was that the idea was that it was getting Christians ready to make a commitment to the Lord in baptism. And so there would be a time of preparation, 40 days of prayer. There'd be a time of fasting, a lot of other stuff in order to do that. And then it kind of got shifted over and they started doing it as an anticipation of Christmas, of the birth of Jesus. And of course, Jesus has already come. But the beautiful thing is now what we celebrate is not that Jesus has come, although he has, but that he will come again. Amen? And so we look forward to his second coming because the Lord is coming soon. And so today we celebrate our first Sunday of Advent, which is as we light the candle of peace. And we got tired of the wands because they never worked, so...
Psalm 27, the Lord is my light and my salvation. Whom shall I fear? The Lord is the stronghold of my life. Of whom shall I be afraid? When the wicked advance against me to devour me, it is my enemies and my foes who will stumble and fall. I remain confident of this, that I will see the goodness of the Lord in the land of the living. Wait for the Lord. Be strong and take heart and wait for the Lord. People waited a long time to see prophecies about the coming Messiah fulfilled, such as this one from Isaiah.
Isaiah chapter 9, verses 6 and 7 says, "For to us a child is born, to us a son is given, and the government will be on his shoulders, and he will be called Wonderful Counselor, Mighty God, Everlasting Father, the Prince of Peace. And of the greatness of his government and peace there will be no end. He will reign on David's throne and over his kingdom, establishing it and upholding it with justice and righteousness from that time on and forever. The zeal of the Lord will accomplish this." And when Jesus was born,
Suddenly a great company of the heavenly host appeared with the angel, praising God and saying, "Glory to God in the highest heaven, and on earth peace to those on whom his favor rests." And that's from Luke 2, 13 through 14. Scripture reminds us that true peace comes from the Spirit of God dwelling within us.
That's why Colossians 3, 15 says, "Let the peace of Christ rule in your hearts, since as members of one body, you were called to peace. And be thankful. Let us remember Christ's birth and commemorate his death and resurrection and anticipate his glorious return. May God grant us his peace today." And all God's people said, amen. And today we're going to celebrate Holy Communion. If you're new with us, you may not know this, but communion is open table here at the temple. And it means that all are welcome. You don't have to be a member here. You don't have to have a name on a list and be checked off or have a hole punched or something like that. It means you are welcome as you are, because Jesus says, "Whosoever will, come." And that's what we want to do today as we celebrate communion. On the night that Jesus was betrayed and on the day before he would give his life up for us, he got together with his disciples, his friends of 3 years, and he said, "This is my body broken for you." And he broke the bread, symbolizing what his body would be done to his body the next day. And after supper, he took the cup and he blessed it. And he said, "This is a cup of a new covenant, not the old covenant, but a new covenant made in my blood." Meaning he was going to say, "I'm all in with you. Will you be all in with me?" And you know, that's a good deal. If you're in business, that's a good deal. That means that everything that Jesus and the Father has is yours, and everything that you have is his. And I'm going to tell you, in that kind of a deal, that's a good deal. That means everything belongs to you when you have the Lord. And so as you come this morning, I don't know what your burdens are, what your struggles are, but I pray that whatever you need from the Lord this morning, you would receive as you take the bread and take the cup. We have the bread and the cup set up over here, and we also have the trash cans that you can place them in the trash cans rather than the buckets, because they made lots of noise last time. And we also have a gluten option because we're cool like that, and we invite you to do that. I'm going to invite you to come through the middle, this section's to come through and go out the wings, and then have the wings come through the middle and go out the sides as well. Let's pray together. Father God, we thank you, and we bless these gifts of bread and juice, and may they be for us the body and the blood of Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Would you come?
Praise the Father, praise the
Thank you. You may be seated. Thank you, worship team. That's awesome. And I love communion. I love the moment when we get to pause and remember the sacrifice that Jesus made for us. Well, this is a time where we normally pass our offering plates and take up our tithes and offerings, but we're not passing plates anymore. But if you'd like to give your tithes and offerings, you can drop them off in the buckets as you leave the worship center this morning. And if you didn't come prepared to give today, you can always go online to templeonline.org and just click the give button. It's a safe and secure platform where you can do your tithing there. That's how my wife and I do it. And remember, I say it all the time, that giving your tithes and offerings, it's not a fundraiser for the church. It's a spiritual discipline that God asks us to do. It's a way of us saying, God, we trust you and we thank you. Our pastor already said that all that is ours is because of God anyway, and it belongs to God. So when we give back to God a portion of what's already his, it's another act of worship. So thank you for your generosity and faithfulness in your tithes and offerings. Couple quick announcements. We are starting on this Wednesday night. We don't have midweek going right now, except for the teenagers. The youth are still meeting on Wednesday nights. We do not have our midweek meals. But on December 2nd, 9th, and 16th, the next three Wednesday nights, I'm going to be teaching a class from 6:30 to 7:30 p.m. called Introduction to Revelation. It's an overview of the book of Revelation. We're going to do a quick flyby over it, but we're going to hit every chapter, and we're going to talk about things like the Antichrist, the Mark of the Beast, the One World Order, what to look for in the coming ages. Where does the coronavirus and COVID-19, where does that fit into what we're living through right now? Is the Antichrist born? Some of it will be speculation, but we're going to cover a whole lot of theology through the book of Revelation. The book of Revelation was not written to ease our curiosity about the end times. The book of Revelation was written to show the glory of God. Chapter 1, verse 1, the revelation of Jesus Christ. Revelation, apocalypto, the removal of the veil of Jesus Christ. We're going to dive into that on Wednesday nights for the next 3 weeks from 6:30 to 7:30. Love to have you come out for it. And then secondly, our men's ministry, our men's group that meets out at Lee's Duck Camp, the group that Lee and I lead, on December 10th, we're doing a beast feast for men and your kids. If you have sons, bring them. That's Thursday, December 10th. The gates will open at 6 p.m. We're going to have all kinds of food. Lee, have you killed a duck this year? Yeah, he's killed a couple. So we're going to have all sorts of food. All men are invited. We're going to hang out and just get to know each other, connect with each other. That's Thursday night, December 10th. Well, let's have a word of prayer. Then our pastor is going to come and bring the word. God, we love you this morning. We thank you so much for the blessings of friendship. God, I thank you for the blessings of a church family. I thank you for allowing my wife and I to move here from Arkansas to be a part of the temple, and what a blessing that is. God, I'm thankful for our pastor and his wife and the way that they're so involved in people's lives and in the ministry. God, I thank you for the team that you've put here at the temple and for all the families that make up this wonderful place and that we're able to be your hands and feet. God, I thank you for the faithfulness in people as they give their tithes and offerings. That enables us to reach people and show people that you love them anyway, and in spite of, not if or because. God, be with our pastor this morning as he brings a message. Open our ears, open our hearts so we can hear it. It's in your name we pray. Amen.
How many of you are excited for Christmas at the movies? Say amen. Yes, yes, yes. Well, I'm going to invite you to turn to Luke chapter 2, verses 10 through 14. And I'm going to ask you to do something kind of different because this is an old tradition, but it's a good tradition. And so I'm going to invite you. That's a new tradition right there. Yeah, we're all going to get blinded. I'm going to invite you to stand for the gospel. Would you stand up if you brought your Bibles? Luke chapter 2, verses 10 through 14, and then I'll have you sit, and we will not have to stand up until at least 12:30 this afternoon. I'm teasing. But the angel of the Lord said to them, "Do not be afraid, for behold, I bring you good news of great joy, which will be for all people. For this day in the city of David, there has been born for you a Savior, who is Christ the Lord? And this will be a sign for you. You will find a baby wrapped in swaddling clothes and lying in a manger. And then suddenly there appeared with the angel a multitude of heavenly hosts. And by the way, my Bible actually says a angelic army. And if you remember a couple weeks ago, we talked about angels. These are warrior angels coming out, praising God and saying, glory to God in the highest heaven and on earth, peace among men with whom he's well pleased. Turn to your neighbor and say, peace. And you may be seated in the presence of the Lord. God's truth is everywhere. Everywhere. We just have to look for it. And one of the places that we find it sometimes is in our culture, in the movies that we watch. And one of those movies, as we start Christmas with the movies today, is A Christmas Story. Now, how many of you all love A Christmas Story? Raise your hands if you love it. Yeah, it's played only about 750,000 times between now and Christmas. I think TBS has like a 72-hour marathon on it. And A Christmas Story is kind of interesting because it was filmed in Cleveland, Ohio, which is not really interesting if you've been to Cleveland. It's kind of the left armpit of Ohio. It was filmed over 11 weeks, and it cost about $3.3 million to film, and it was released in November of 1983. What was interesting about it is that Darren McGavin is the only famous actor in the movie. He is the one who played the dad. In fact, half of the production budget went to pay his salary. But what's interesting is that he was actually the second choice. The first choice was Jack Nicholson, but they couldn't afford him. And that would have been a completely different movie. And it'd be like, you know, Christmas Story meets The Shining or something like that. It would be really, really bad. But the story of A Christmas Story really revolves around 9-year-old Ralphie Parker, whose sole mission in life is to, and let me make sure I get this right, get a Red Ryder carbine action 200-shot range model air rifle BB gun with a compass in the stock. That's what he wanted. That was his whole mission in life. That was what he was absolutely obsessed with. Right. That's good. Thank you. And that's what it is. And by the way, if Ralphie had lived in Texas, he would have wanted something more like this, the Red Ryder AR-15 on sale now in your local Walmarts. But he wants this Red Ryder BB gun. He's obsessed with it. And everywhere he goes, he gets shut down. Everybody tells him, you're going to shoot your eye out. He tells his mom, and his mom says, I'm not going to get you that. You're going to shoot your eye out. He writes this beautiful essay to his teacher, and the teacher basically gives him a really bad grade, and P.S., you're going to shoot your eye out. Even when he appeals to the big guy, Santa, and he says, I want a Red Ryder BB gun, and he goes through the whole thing. Santa goes, you'll shoot your eye out, kid. But, you know, he's undeterred. He is, if he just can maneuver, if he can just persuade, if he can just cajole, he will get the Red Ryder BB gun, and then everything in life will be perfect. Go ahead and watch this clip. Oh, we teased you, and then we pulled it away. It was a terrible thing. I could act it out. That's okay. So here's the clip. Can I just tell you the clip? Because this ruins it. Okay. The clip is he's standing there at the store window, and he sees it, and he says, there it is, basically the Mecca, the thing, the golden goose, the thing that he's looking for all of Christmas, the Red Ryder BB gun, and he can't wait. Because he's obsessing about the idea of if he can get this gun, then all kinds of wonderful things will be able to happen. He'll be able to stave off the invaders that come after his family. His family will be saved because of it. He's so super excited about getting this gun. And when he finally gets the gun, it almost isn't worth it. Because first of all, he almost shoots his eye out. That's one thing. He ends up breaking his glasses. It opens up a whole series of events where he ends up leaving the door open while he's getting his face attended to. And the Bumpuses, the next door, their neighbors, 700 of their dogs come through the house and they devour the Christmas turkey that Dad is just waiting for. He's been waiting for this thing for days upon days. And then they have to go to the Chinese restaurant to eat, and they bring out, y'all remember, they bring out the duck, and the duck has the duck head still on it. It's probably one of the 290 duck heads that or ducks that Lee has killed out there. And then possibly the scene that is probably the most politically incorrect scene in all of movie history, they have to listen to the waiters sing Deck the Halls, which I can't even show you. I mean, it's that bad. I can't even show you. But it's hysterical when you watch it. And so Ralphie is just absolutely obsessed with this BB gun. He can't wait. But you know, I noticed something when I watched this movie again that I hadn't noticed before. Maybe you haven't noticed it. It usually goes unnoticed. One day after being teased and bullied mercilessly at school, Ralphie loses it, and he just goes off on this bully, and he pummels him and just beats the tar out of him. And while he's doing it, he's cussing him out, and his mother comes out, and he hears him, and she grabs him, and she says, "You're going to your room," and then she says the words that every kid dreads, "Just wait until your father comes home." Anybody else have that, like, the fear of God put in them when they were children? Yeah, I mean, just the thought. And so there he is in a cold sweat up in his room fearing the absolute worst punishment. And then all of a sudden, he hears his father come home. Now, this has been so bad that his brother Randy is actually hiding under the sink crying. And when Mom asks Randy what's going on, Randy says, "Daddy's gonna kill Ralphie." You know, this is bad. I mean, he's just waiting for the worst punishment. And then, in a strange turn of events, when the dad asks, how did everything go today? What happened today? The mom says, "Oh, not much. You know, Ralphie got into a fight, but it's not a big deal. You know how boys are. Oh, honey, by the way, did you hear that the Bears are playing the Packers tonight?" And a big smile comes across Ralphie's face as he realizes the greatest gift is the gift of grace, the gift of grace. Friends, the greatest gift that we can receive this Christmas is the gift of grace. What is it that you wanted for Christmas as a kid? When I was a kid, in the late 70s, early 80s, we would get the Sears and Roebuck Christmas Wish Book. How many of y'all actually remember the Christmas Wish Book? The greatest thing ever. I loved it. And I wanted to get the Charlie McCarthy ventriloquist doll. There's actually a picture. That's it. He's up there with the monocle and the top hat. That's what I wanted, that thing. I want you to know I dog-eared that page. I circled it. I underlined it. And I laid it on my mom's and dad's bed just so that they would get the hint. I was dropping so many hints like crazy. And I did not get that. Instead, I got the... yeah, go show them. The Donnie and Marie toy guitar. And that doesn't even do it just. It was lilac colored. Lilac colored. Would that be considered bougie? Is that considered bougie? I don't know. That might be, yeah. Needless to say, I didn't get what I wanted. I was kind of too afraid to tell Mom and Dad because I felt bad that they put money out for something I didn't want. I don't know what you want for this Christmas, but maybe all of us are kind of a little bit like Ralphie. I call it the pursuit of the thing. Whatever the thing is, it's the key to opening up everything else in life. It's the key to happiness. It's the key to joy. It's the key to satisfaction and contentment. It's the thing. And we all want the thing. If I could just have the thing, the perfect marriage, the perfect spouse, the perfect house, the perfect job, the perfect body, more money, whatever it might be, perfect kids, if I could just have the thing, then everything in my life would be absolutely excellent. It would be perfect. But see, in all of this, we miss the greatest gift that's ever given, and that's Jesus Christ. Amen? That's the greatest gift. See, all of this gift giving really started with God. You know, the Bible actually says, "For God so loved the world that he," what? Gave. He gave. He's the first one to give. He gave his only son that whoever believes in him shall not perish but have eternal life. God's a giver. God's a giver. And he's been a giver, and he's the one who gave. And he's the best present that we can ever receive, because with him, something comes along with the package when we get Jesus. With Jesus comes pardon. With Jesus comes pardon. Luke chapter 2 verse 11 says, "For this day in the city of David, there has been born for you a Savior who is Christ the Lord." A Savior. God sent a Savior because that's what we needed. You know, if God knew we needed information, he would have sent us a news reporter. Maybe. I don't know. That might be controversial today. If God knew that we needed technology, he would have sent an IT specialist, right? If God knew that we needed money, he would have sent a banker. But God knew we needed forgiveness, so he sent a Savior. He sent Jesus. And the beautiful thing is that every one of us has sinned and fallen short of the glory of God, but God has provided us a Savior. He sent a Savior. Every one of us needs pardon. That's what Christmas is all about. It's all about grace. Christmas is all about pardon. Christmas is all about forgiveness. And the beautiful things about God's gift of pardon is that we don't have to do anything to earn it, just like what we sang. We don't have to do anything. We have to be good boys and good girls and get stars on our calendar and get a whole week of stars, and then we get grace. The beautiful thing is that we don't have to do it, because it's not because of anything that we did. It's because of what he did. It's not because I'm good, because I'm not good, y'all. Amen? Don't look at me like I'm the only one in the room, okay? It's not because I'm good, it's because he's good. And we don't have to do anything to earn his love, to earn his forgiveness. When you receive the gift of pardon, God sees you in a new light. He sees you as righteous. Those old rags of sin are taken off, and a new robe of righteousness is given to you. And so when he looks at you, he doesn't see your sin. He doesn't see your brokenness. He sees you as a whole person, a person who is righteous and forgiven, a son, a daughter in God. That's how he sees you. And he heals your brokenness. He heals your struggle. You know, pardon is a big deal. Forgiveness is a big deal. There is a girl, a woman, who's a police officer named Amber Geiger. And after a long shift at work, she came home one night and opened an apartment door. And a man was sitting there eating some cereal. And she figured that the man had broken into her apartment. And so she pulled a gun, and when the man got up to try to say something, she shot him and killed him. His name was Botham Jean. Turns out it wasn't her apartment, it was his apartment. She'd gotten confused because of a long shift. And at the trial where they were trying her, Botham Jean's brother, Brant Jean, testified. And this is what he said. Listen to this. He said, "I don't want to see you rot and die. I don't want to see you go to prison. I forgive you. I love you. I want you to give your life to Jesus Christ," because that's what Botham would want. And there was an audible gasp in the courtroom as he asked this incredible next step. He asked the judge, he said, can I hug her? Can I give her a hug? The judge kind of hesitated and said, "Okay." And they met in the middle of the courtroom, and Amber just held on to Brant for dear life, crying, weeping, absolutely repenting. And then in a more incredible course of events, the judge actually gave her her Bible. And you know, that is a wonderful exhibit of forgiveness and pardon. But here's the thing. It doesn't change the fact that Botham Jean is dead. It doesn't change the fact that somebody has to pay for his death. In fact, she was sentenced still to 10 years in prison because of it. And I want you to understand that sin means that we have to have payment. There has to be payment for our sin. But the beautiful good news of Jesus Christ, the good news of the gospel, is that you and I have received forgiveness because Jesus paid it all. He paid it all. See, the thing that people don't understand about the Bible, the thing that people don't understand about God, the thing that people don't understand about Christians and about church is this simple fact, and it's that Jesus did not come to rub our noses in our sin. Jesus came to rub out our sin forever and ever. Amen. That's who he is. He's a savior. This Christmas, don't miss the gift of pardon. It's the greatest gift you can receive. With Jesus comes pardon, but with Jesus also comes peace. Luke chapter 2, verse 14, it says, "Glory to God in the highest, and on earth peace among men whom he is well pleased." Peace. In World War I, 16 million people died. In 1914, 8 months into the war, it was Christmas Eve. And the Germans and the Brits were fighting from their trenches, and it would have been fierce, fierce warfare, just a war of attrition, terrible warfare. In fact, if you go to England today, any little town that you go into, a little hamlet you can drive into, and there'll be a monument to the war dead, hundreds of them. And one time in the evening, as the battle had ceased, all of a sudden a German soldier began to sing "O Holy Night," the hymn, the Christmas hymn. When the British heard it from their trenches, they began to sing along. And when they finished the hymn, the German soldier in broken English said, "You don't shoot, and we don't shoot." And the Brits yelled back, "You don't shoot, and we don't shoot." And they met in the middle of the battlefield, and they helped each other clear out their dead. And then on Christmas Day, they had a meal together. And then you know what they did? They played soccer. It's a very English thing to do, right? They played soccer. And for 6 days, they had a truce. All because one soldier sang, "Truly he taught us to love one another. His law is love, and his gospel is peace." Who do you know that can bring that kind of peace but Jesus? He's the Prince of Peace. I don't know anybody who can bring that kind of peace. Jesus said in John 14, 27, he said, "Peace I leave with you. My peace I give to you. Not as the world gives. So do not let your hearts be troubled. Neither let them be afraid." Now, how does the world give peace? The world gives peace conditionally. As long as I get the thing, then I have peace. I'm happy. I have inner peace. But Jesus gives us his peace that is unconditional. It's the peace that says no matter what is happening, war can be breaking out around you, but you have peace on the inside because he's the Prince of Peace. If you want peace today, he offers it to you. What you need to do is you need to come to Jesus. See, peace isn't a pill. It's not a program. It's not a philosophy. It's a person. He's the Prince of Peace. And he said, "Come as you are." You know, the craziest thing in the world is when people say, "Oh, I can't come to church. If I walked into church, the ceiling would fall in. Man, that roof would cave in. You wouldn't want me in your church. I've done too many bad things in my life." As if we have to clean up before we go to church. Let me ask you, do you get well to go to a doctor? Then why in the world would we think that we have to get our life together to come to Jesus? You come to Jesus just as you are, and he puts your life back together. He puts it back together. That's what he does. And then we come to Jesus, but we connect with Jesus. See, Matthew chapter 11, 28 and 29 says, "Come to me, all who labor and are heavy laden." That's fancy language to say the burdens, the weight of the world is on your shoulders. He says, "Come to me. Take and I will give you rest. Take my yoke upon you and learn from me. For I am gentle and humble in heart, and you will find rest for your souls." It's a weird language there. He says, "Take my yoke upon you." When they would put two oxen together, they would use a yoke that would, it's a neck yoke. My uncle, who lived in Nebraska, always used to tell us kids that he threatened to beat us with a neck yoke. That's what he would always do. So that's how I know how a neck yoke is. He'd always point up to the wall and say, I'm going to beat you with the neck yoke. But they would do, what they would do is they would put these oxen together and they would do it in such a way they would match them where the older, more mature ox was matched with the younger, immature ox. And that way, the older, more mature ox would bear the brunt of the load that they were carrying. And the younger, less mature ox would learn to lean in on the older, more mature ox. Friends, if you're coming today, you're here today, and you've got some burdens, you've got some heaviness, you've got a sense that the world is on your shoulders, you're worried about your job, you're worried about the future, you're worried about money, you're worried about kids, you're worried about this country, you're worried about where the world's going. I want you to hear me when I say this, that what you need to do is get in the yoke with Jesus. I know that's weird language for people who are in an agrarian society, but we need to get in the yoke with Jesus and learn from him and lean on him, because he will take your burdens away. He will carry the brunt of your burdens. That's what he specializes in. He'll take the load off. That's where you find peace. You don't find peace in the thing, in the conditions. You find peace in the unconditional world of Jesus, which offers you that peace that no matter what happens, he's helping you. He's carrying the load. So we come to Jesus, we connect with Jesus, but we connect with Jesus. He says something in there. He says, learn from me. You know, it's great to come in and listen to a sermon. But what this text really teaches me is that change is a process. It takes time. We have to learn to lean on Jesus. There used to be an old hymn, learning to lean, I'm learning to lean, I'm learning to lean on Jesus. And that's exactly what we're doing. We're learning to lean on Jesus. And our commitment as a church, as leaders in the church, our commitment to you for this next year is that we're going to give you the tools, the resources, and the experiences to be more committed daily to Jesus, to learn how to lean on Jesus. And my prayer, my hope is that you take advantage of them. I hope that you don't say, well, I'll do midweek another time, small groups next year. Take it. Don't let them go by. Take advantage of them. I know we're busy. We're always going to be busy. We always fill our life with busyness. But if we fill our life with the Lord, man, God multiplies our life in such a way that we can't even imagine it. Can somebody say amen to that? Because I think it's true. I know it's true. And so with Jesus comes pardon, with Jesus comes peace, and with Jesus comes his presence. Matthew 1:23, in another part of the Christmas story that's told in the Gospel of Matthew, it says, behold, the virgin shall conceive and bear a son, and they shall call his name what? Emmanuel, which means what? God with us. What does that mean? It means that no matter what you go through in life, God's going to be with you. The Lord said to us in Hebrews chapter 13, verse 5, he said, I will never leave you nor forsake you. The New Testament was written in Greek, and in that text is five negatives. And so when you read it, you actually have to, it kind of reads this way. It says, I will never, no, not ever, no, never leave nor forsake you. Isn't that cool? I will never, no, not ever, no, never leave nor forsake you. That's a commitment from the Lord. Can we say that's a pretty good commitment? Amen. I mean, that he's saying, I'm throwing down here. If God is with you, God will be with you forever. He's with you in the darkest times that you go through. When storms are happening in your life. You know, I was reading up on hurricanes because I figured might as well. Because when you live in Hurricane Alley, you need to get to know your windy friend, you know. And so I was learning about hurricanes. I found something really interesting. They said that the eye of the storm is the calmest part of the hurricane. And they said the reason for that is because the surface winds never ever reach the eye. And it forms kind of this cylinder of calm air. And so all around you may be craziness. All around it may be storms. But in the eye, it is calm. In Matthew chapter 14, the disciples get into a boat and they're going across the lake. And these are experienced fishermen. They're experienced in using the boat. But a storm comes up, and it was a bad storm. The winds are howling, and the waves are coming over the front of the boat, and they're going down. They're feeling like we are going to drown right here. And the Bible says that the storm still happened at 3 a.m. Have you ever been in a storm at 3 a.m.? I'm talking about a storm of life that seems to go on forever and ever and ever without letting up. A storm that keeps you up at night. A storm where you're just pushing and pulling and nothing is working. A storm where you're tossing and turning and being thrown to and fro. I'm talking about a storm that you just can't get out of. Have you ever been in a storm like that? Amen? They were in that storm. It says that in the midst of the storm, Jesus, I love this, Jesus comes walking on the water. Storm's not bothering Jesus. He's not affected by the winds. He's not affected by the water. He's not affected by anything. He's walking on the water. And they saw him and they said, oh my goodness, it's a ghost. And they freaked out and they started screaming. And Jesus said, take heart, do not be afraid. And then he says, it is I. Did you catch it? It is I. Say that with me. It is I. Jesus is saying to us, if you're in the middle of the storm and you're with me, you are in the I of the storm. It's going to be okay. He's going to get you through because he's been through enough to know that he will be enough in the midst of the storm. You're going to make it through. When you're with him, he will get you through this storm, whatever it might be. That's his promise to us, friends. He gives us his peace. He gives us his pardon. He gives us his presence. And you're going to make it. You're going to make it because of Jesus. You know, I don't know what you want for Christmas. Maybe you're like Ralphie and you want the thing that's going to make you happy. But I'm here to tell you that the greatest gift that you can ever receive is Jesus Christ. He's the greatest gift because he gives pardon through his forgiveness. He gives peace by learning to lean on him. And he gives his presence, which is with you in the midst of the storm. What more could you ask for than that? He's not just enough. He's more than enough. Would you stand? Just bow your heads this morning. And I'm just going to ask you, with every head bowed and every eye closed, was this sermon for you? If it was for you, would you raise your hand and say, this sermon was for me today. I needed to hear that. Okay, thank you. Praise God. We're going to ask the Lord to yoke up with us. So, Lord, we just ask that you would yoke up with us, that you would link up with us, that you would connect with us. Lord, because we know with you that we don't have to carry these burdens alone. We can give them to you. You can bear the brunt. And so today, God, we ask that you would take those burdens from us. Help us take a load off today. Lord, help us in the midst of the storm to have peace as we lean on you. And help us to know that your presence is here. And Lord, if there's one person, just one person here today who says, I need the pardon that Jesus offers. I need the forgiveness. I pray that you would just say, Lord Jesus, save me. Forgive me of my sins. And set me free. You don't have to have a fancy prayer. Just, you can say it to him there. And he'll take you on that. Thank you, Lord, for your goodness, for your love, for your mercy today. Thank you for Jesus, who's come as our Savior to set us free. And all God's people said, amen. Now, before you leave, turn to a neighbor and say, I'm glad that you got to sit with me today. Now turn to your other neighbor and say, I'm sure you're glad that you got to sit with me too. All right. God bless you all. Have a fantastic week. The Lord bless you.